Good morning and welcome to our online service. My name is Alex and we are Carpenter's Church meeting in many homes across the city. I'm so excited that this Sunday morning is the first Sunday that as a Connect group we are meeting together in our home to meet as a church. We're going to watch the online service together and talk about it and pray together. It is so amazing to be able to be together, socially distanced, but still just be together and meet as a church. I encourage you in thinking of next Sunday, who you can invite into your home, who you can meet with as a church to engage in the online service together, to talk about it and pray together and encourage one another as the church. This morning, we want to take a couple minutes at the beginning of our service to celebrate something really exciting. We had a number of students from the Project Youth Ministry graduate this year. A number of them graduated from grade 8, and it was strange not being able to celebrate the same way that we normally do. But we also had 4 grade 12 grads this year. That is so exciting. Aaliyah, Kindred, Sergey, and Austin, they worked hard. They didn't give up, and they accomplished an amazing thing. They graduated grade 12, and I know that Aaliyah and Kindred also won special awards for perseverance and Kindred for most improved student. Congratulations, guys. You worked so hard. We are so proud of you. Now let's celebrate as we watch a video that we've put together of these youth reflecting on some of their experience at the project the past number of years.
What is your favorite memory at the project?
When Dylan went through the wall. Buddy Alley, they're wrestling or whatever, you know, playing floor hockey. I think it was floor hockey. And Buddy lifted it up and just put him right through the wall butt first. Everyone was laughing. That was a great night, yeah.
What advice would you give to your 13-year-old self?
Well, first thing, when I was 13, you know, I thought I was the center of the world. And I thought that I had it all on my own, like, you know, that I could be strong only for myself and then everyone else around me. But what I didn't realize was I needed people. That was my biggest problem, was I thought I didn't need any help. So allowing people to be there for you, allowing them to help you, and opening yourself up and allowing yourself to feel what you need to feel, and talking to people and, you know, trusting them, I think that's one of the biggest things that I would have told myself then, because that helped me a lot. And I should have learned that a lot earlier. So that's what I've told myself.
What do you hope for your future?
To join the military. I want to become a weapons technician or something like that.
Austin, what is your favorite memory at the project?
Seeing you guys on Friday, you know, after a long week, you know, and just hang out and chill.
What advice would you give to your 13-year-old self?
Stay in school, you know, listen to your parents. My sister, she's quite rebellious, so she's living the hard life now because she's deciding the wrong path.
What do you hope for your future?
I hope to either be somewhere in the business industry or somewhere in construction.
What's your favorite memory at the project?
Going camping.
Do you want to share more about that experience?
My favorite memory would be when we went to Dream Camp. And going on the canoe with Alex and tipping over. And that was fun.
What advice would you give to your 13-year-old self?
Not to care so much about what people think of me. Friends don't last.
What do you hope for your future?
To do good. I don't know.
Well, congratulations again to our grade 12 grads. We are so proud of you, and we love you no matter what. Would you join me in praying for our grade 12 grads this morning and in the coming months as they transition into a new season? Jesus, I thank you that we can meet together as a church, whether it is online with the larger gathering or in our homes with a few members. I thank you, Father, that you are present with us, that you're not just with us, but you're inside of us. The fullness and presence and power of Jesus inside of us, his people. I pray, Father, that you would help us to understand that more and more. I thank you, Father, that although these four graduates are moving on to whatever's next in their lives, I pray that we'd be able to stay connected with them. I pray that you would lead them and you would guide them and that they would know, Father, that you are with them, that they would invite your presence with them daily. They would live in the power of the Holy Spirit, and they would know that nothing is more important than a relationship with you. I thank you for the many highs and lows we've been able to navigate with them, and I thank you that we can worship you this morning. We can learn about you. Jesus, you are good. Amen. Well, if you have kids in the room, invite them, get them ready. We're going to sing a very energetic, upbeat song to kick things off today. And parents, lead the way. Don't take yourself too seriously. We're going to do some actions and dance around, have some fun worshiping Jesus this morning.
Surrounded, your love is everywhere and I'm surrounded. It's got me singing, it's got me shouting, and now I wanna tell the world about it. Cause now I am alive, yeah, you opened up my eyes. Everywhere I look I see.
Carpenter's Church. Good morning, children, kids, moms and dads, whole families. We're so excited to be together today. Let's just worship Jesus together in spirit and truth.
Stone, this solid ground, firm through the
the fiercest drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by could sing of your love forever. Praise you, God. Jesus, you are so good. I could sing of your love forever.
Praise you, Jesus.
Thank you that out of all of the beautiful, breathtaking things that you've created, you love us the most.
Praise you, God.
You call us your prized possession. Thank you, Lord, that we can live in a country where we are free to worship you and that it pleases you when we do. Lord, make us aware of your presence this morning. Holy Spirit, give us wisdom and understanding of your word. And God, make us more like you. In your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, you are going to have an opportunity to give to God now. If you want to do that and you're joining us on our online platform, you can click the Give button in the chat box. Otherwise, you can visit our website, carpenters.church, and follow the giving instructions on there, or you can always mail or deliver check or cash to our building at 1339 Avenue D North. If it's your first time giving through e-transfer this morning, be sure to add your name into the comments so that we can know who you are and get you a tax receipt. At Carpenter's Kids, we love to talk about money. We think that it's really important that our kids know why we give to God. And often we will ask them that question, why do we give to God? And one morning, one of our boys said, we give to God because God needs our money. And he was quite shocked to discover that God doesn't actually need our money. He doesn't need anything. He's God. So then, why do we give money to him? In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus is recorded saying, give as freely as you have received. We do not give to God because he needs our money. We give in response to his generosity. And when we give, we are reminded of how freely we have received because of what Christ has done for us. I'm praying this morning that God will bless you with that reminder as you give.
Good morning and welcome to Carpenter's Church Online. And today, I'm excited. I've been excited watching everything that's gone on so far. Great thing with the kids, and Alex and April did a great job. And I hope you kids have enjoyed stuff today. And this morning, we gather in homes throughout the city as a church. We all know that church is more than just a building. And so wherever we're meeting in homes throughout the city today, you are in church. Where two or three are gathered, there I am in the midst, Jesus said. And so you know what? The thing is, it's awesome that we can gather together. And we encourage you to join with others and invite people into your home. And we just ask that you would just be aware and maintain the social distancing guidelines that have been given to us by our government. And let's continue to pray for our political leaders. That they would have wisdom and insight as to how to manage these reopening steps within our province and across Canada, really. Let's remember also to be thankful and pray for our frontline workers, those that are involved in our health region and are dealing with people that are ill and sick and COVID or not, but we thank God for these people. And we pray for them. Remember them. If you're visiting online this morning, we just want to say a welcome. And we desire to connect with each and every one of you that are watching here as well. Visitors and those who would watch this on a regular basis. And we desire to connect with you and you to connect with us. So please take advantage of the buttons that you can access on the online platform. There's a connect button. There's a pray button. You can even invite other people to the service this morning online. And someone will meet with you. Someone is on the other side of this camera. Just want you to know that. This morning, we launch into a new series of messages looking into the Gospel of John. From John's account of Jesus, his personal eyewitness encounter of all Jesus did and all Jesus said. And from this, we glean some life lessons that we can apply to our daily living. The Word of God is timeless. That means it's not restricted to just a certain place and time, but can be just as insightful and practical and powerful for all who read it whenever in history that we do read it. For we believe these are God's words to us and for us as humanity. And today, as we launch this series, we introduce John the disciple. Let's just pray real quick. God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God, that you have already been presencing yourself through the worship. And now we pray for the word that we would just be able to glean from this disciple, this John, as he witnessed Jesus, as he tells the story of Jesus. In this gospel account, God, may we understand what we can apply to our life as we go through the things that we face. Amen. Scripture in Matthew chapter 4, verses 18, and then you jump ahead to 21, 22. It says this: Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw Simon called Peter and two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother. He called them. And immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. These are the first ones. These are the first disciples that Jesus calls. There are three of them. They're fishermen. And he meets them on the shore, the Sea of Galilee, and he calls them. He says, come follow me, and they leave everything behind, and they follow him. Now, Jesus calls 12 disciples in total, but these three had a unique and close relationship with Jesus. You see, they had a unique access to some of the events that others didn't, and so John, we know as well as one of these ones, of these three. Peter calls him the disciple whom Jesus loved. You read that in John 21, 20. But that's why we know him as, maybe you've heard this term before, John the Beloved. John the Beloved. Jesus also refers to the two brothers as well, and he calls them the sons of thunder. And perhaps there was a tendency, you know, for these individuals to speak out quite freely and loudly at times, and that's why Jesus dubbed them this. So John gives us a little snapshot into his character. A little excitable. I can relate to that. And used words. I can relate to that. A little bit loud. And I can relate to that. Luke 9:51 and verses following tell us about that. But John was being so closely involved with Jesus right from the very beginning. And he gives us a unique glimpse into the life. John now is penning these words. He's an old man, and he's writing the account, and he's looking back. He's writing from the place of Ephesus. Now, we understand Ephesus because that was the last series that we talked about, the book of Ephesus. And these faithful followers in Ephesus are the church in this location. And John is in this place now, and that's when he writes his account and the story that we can read. It was probably written around between 80 and 90 AD. And, you know, John would have been aware also of the other gospel accounts. He would have been aware of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And he would have been aware of those. And what he does is he writes to reflect the major themes of Jesus' life and ministry. And he wanted to and desired to testify of Christ, that these readings, and listen to what he says in John 20 and 31 from his very own words. He says that others may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and may have life in his name. That's his theme. That's the desire of what he was trying to do and taking this message of Jesus and sharing it with others. You know, every single one of us, if we take a snapshot of our life now, it doesn't matter whether we're at the beginning, in the middle, or kind of on the golden side of life. You know what? We might call it a journey or whatever it is. But in this life, we're at different stages. But even though we might be at different stages, we're facing many of the same things that come our way. Each one of us is asking questions like, why am I here? You know, what am I supposed to be doing? How come this happened? What is the purpose of my life? They're sobering reflections, but there's times in our life, in the busyness and the play and everything else, we have those quiet times where we wonder about these things. It's just our humanity. What do people say about me? What influence do I have? What influence can I have? What will I be remembered for? What legacy will I leave? And I believe when he writes this gospel account, John is reflecting upon all of these life questions of humanity. And you know what he does about this thing? He doesn't make it about himself, because when you read the gospel account, he's not talking about, you know, him. He's talking about the central figure of what he desired to talk about and to share and to spread was the good news of Jesus. And that becomes the focal point of everything that John was about. We're introducing this series by just looking at him a little bit in his character. But we're looking into the gospel account of John. You know, when I first encountered the gospel, John, I was 17 years old. I just want to say, you know, if you don't know my story at all and haven't heard about anything about me, you know, I was a disillusioned kid at that point in time in life. And I was, you know, trying to work out, you know, what was going on and what I was supposed to be doing and what I was supposed to be out. You know, I was seeking, but I wasn't finding any satisfaction. I was purposeless. I was looking at what is my life, you know, all about? What am I supposed to be doing? Where am I going? And really, I found myself in this place of lost. It was very close to my graduating year, and some of you guys have graduated, and we saw a video today of that, and congratulations. And you know what? You know, we reflect on what was and everything else, but that was me, you know, reflecting in this time of life and realizing life hadn't really turned out the way and wasn't turning out what I was desiring and no direction. And this is when someone gave me a little book. It was a little New Testament, and it's this very book. This is the first Bible that I ever was given. It's a New Life Living Testament paraphrase version. And you know what? I got this little Bible given to me, and I was at this time in my life, and I was like, oh, wow, woohoo, a Bible. You have to understand, I didn't come from a believing background. We didn't go to church as a family growing up. We went to, you know, funerals, weddings, but even at Easter and Christmas, that was just like Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny, seriously. I had no clue or concept of Jesus. I had no concept of God. I had no concept of Bible. I had no concept, other than what I had gleaned you know, growing up as a teenager and you know, mocking, you know, things and poking fun at, and but not really knowing what was really going on. And so I pick up this little New Testament and I you know, flip the first pages, and there's Matthew, okay, and then there's Mark, okay, and I knew enough somehow, some way to know that these guys were disciples of Jesus, and it comes to Luke, and then it comes to this book of John, and I stopped there, and I went, and here's the, you know, whatever, it tells you where I was at in life, a little cocky, but at lost at the same time, but I thought, man, I should maybe start, if I'm going to read this thing, read John, because that's my name. And you might think that's kind of shallow, but that's what my thought process was. I was 17 years old, looking for direction, and I was like, wow. You know, I started reading this gospel account. I started reading John, and you know what? I didn't pray because I didn't know what prayer was. You know, I really didn't know, and like I said, I wasn't a Christian, not a follower, didn't believe, was not a religious person, and it was kind of more of a challenge thought, and cocky, yes, again, but I said, you know, if you are real, if you're real, God, you know, prove yourself to me. Prove yourself to me. And like I said, it wasn't a prayer, it was more of a thing, but I was desperate. You know, I just want to stop here and say, you know what? There's times in our life where we can find ourselves at times desperate. It's just a word that describes a place in our lives that is just not a good place to be. We're desperate, we're lost, we're lonely, and maybe that's you this morning. And I just want to encourage you, if you find yourself in a desperate place, don't stop there in that place of being desperate. Because you know what? You can go through this. And it is just, I believe, a season in your life that will change. And so I found myself in this place of desperate. I found myself, you know, regardless of all the stuff I'd been taught and gleaned as a young guy or whatever, I was willing to take a little bit of a risk here and start reading something that was new to me. Because I was desperate. You see, all the answers all the trying to get answers for the questions I had, it wasn't working. So this is what I did. If you're real, God, prove yourself to me. So I started reading. And listen to the very first words that I ever read from the Bible. John 1:1. Before anything else existed, there was Christ with God. He has always been alive and is himself God. And he created everything there is, and nothing exists that he didn't make. Eternal life is in him, and the life gives light to all mankind. And his life is the light that shines through the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Okay, I'm reading this, and then I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. What did I just read? Now, you got to understand, even though I was not a church person, I was very, you know, I read lots of different things, and I was reading all the time, and so picking this up and reading it, I'm like, okay, and you know, as I started to read it, I did do this. I knew that Jesus was a real historical figure. Nobody ever denied his existence. I'd never heard that. And so I'm like, okay, this is Jesus, and this is a story his friend has written about, you know, who Jesus was. I kind of was a smart guy, maybe too smart sometimes for my own good, but I was aware of stuff. And so I'm reading this in context, but I read these words about Jesus, and I'm just like, you know, you got to be kidding me. What do you mean this Jesus? And you know what? I went back and read them. Before anything else existed, there was Christ with God. He has always been alive and is himself God. He created everything there is. Nothing exists that he didn't make. Eternal life is in him. And this life gives light to all mankind. His life is the light that shines through the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. The first five verses of John. What do you mean Jesus always has been? Jesus is the same as God? Like, Jesus is God? Like, these are the first words. I've never read anything like this. I've never heard anybody even talk about this stuff before. You know, have you ever seen those stories on Facebook or on YouTube, and it's somebody who's never heard before, and they've gone through an operation where something's been attached to the side of their head, and then there's some electrodes and stuff, and there's a technician, and what they're doing is they're looking at their screen or whatever, and then they're sending sound, and then they're, you know, and the person's starting to hear for the very first time. And then there's this one of this baby, and the first time this baby ever hears its mother's voice, you see just the bewilderment and the joy and just the wow, like this wow moment, like you got to be kidding me type of a thing. It's my words, probably not a baby's. And then there's crying and there's laughing and joy, and it's unreal. I've seen these people that have been colorblind, and then they get these special glasses and they put these glasses on and they see color for the very first time, and you see the excitement and the joy and the wonder, and they're crying, they're laughing because of this experience. I am in my bedroom and I'm reading this at night with my nightlight on, and I'm just like, you've got to be kidding me. This is absolutely amazing. What I'm reading, it's like a light switch has been turned on somehow. And God's speaking to my life. These opening words captured my attention. They intrigued me. They drew me in. And they caused me to read further into this gospel account. My mind was racing. Something started stirring within me. Tell me more. I need to read more. And as I read more, something was changing in my mind and in my heart. And my life was being stirred, and I believe my life was starting to change. The way I look at life started to change. The way I looked at Jesus started to change. The way I looked at people, the way I looked at my family. Because I started to realize this guy just isn't a historical figure, but he's alive right now, according to what this is saying. And I started like looking around. I like, honestly, I started like, okay, if he's still around, like, he's still around. And I started watching and I started looking, and this was in my mind. Jesus is present. And then I realized he loves me. He died for me. He rose from the dead. And I'm thinking, this is crazy. The God of this universe came down and dwelt among us. He became flesh. God became man. Okay. And I was excited about this. But you know what? I'm still too cool to really show this on the outside. I'm just too cool, right? So I'm just kind of, this is an inner thing that's going on, and it's welling up within me. But he knows me. He loves me. He wants to be involved in my life. I'm starting to read this, and I'm starting to get some clarity, and I'm just kind of going, this is more than a story. So one night, you know, I put my little book down beside my grow your own stone because I was a kid. I was involved with drugs and, you know, on the West Coast. Smoked a lot of marijuana in my younger years. Just saying. Didn't know anything about God, church, or anything, Christianity, religion. I put my little Bible down beside my Grow Your Own Stone book. And for the first time, I prayed. And I simply said this. I said, Jesus, forgive my sins. Come into my heart. I didn't really understand. I didn't know that that was a prayer. It was kind of me just talking with God. Because it was like conversational. Because he was real. He was in my room. He saw me. He knew me. Read your Bible. Read the Bible. Read the Gospel of John. You see, you know, it will enable you to receive answers and direction and receive purpose for your life. And I would say to you, it will transform you. My life was heading down a very different path, and it wasn't a great path. And Jesus has opened up an amazing life experience for me. I just want to say that. That is my testimony. And I would testify of the reality of Christ and how he has not only saved me as a young man, but he gave me direction. He gave me purpose. And the wonderful things that I have experienced in this life, the fullness of life, in my marriage, in my wife, my family, my girls, and all the things that can come along have been so much more enriched and purposeful because of my relationship with Jesus. Because that's the relationship. God became man because God knew that we needed the closeness of relationship. And that's what God desired as well. He was distant. And he came down to dwell among us. And as we go in further into this Gospel of John, as we read the account, the eyewitness account of John and what he experienced, it can transform and change your life. As you allow that truth of who Jesus is and what Jesus desires for each and every one of us. Amazing. Because God wants to change our life. Lessons for living. God became man so that we could relate. And he could relate to us. And just build that relationship. Would you pray with me? Jesus, thank you that you indeed are God. That's what it says. The Word was with God and the Word was God. You were present at all creation. Nothing's been created without you being aware of it. Everything has been created through you. Nothing has been created without you, God. That amazes me. And it tells me how much you love us because we were created in your image. We can go to Psalm 139, Lord, and we can see how that we were knit together in our mother's womb when you saw us when we were being created and formed. Right from our beginning. And your intention is to love us, to come alongside of us, to encourage us that we might live a full and rich life. You don't want to rain on a parade, God. You don't want to take away from. You want to give. So God, I pray this morning if people are listening to this and saying, I just need a change in my life. I need a transformation. God, may they understand that they can have the beginning of that today as they would call out to you in their own way. and just say, Jesus, help me. It doesn't matter, God, whether they be at the very beginning of their journey and they're young, or they're halfway between, or maybe on the other side of those golden years. God, I pray that they would sense that they have opportunity to call out to you, whether they be non-believing or whether they would be, God, a believer that's been in church for years. God, you will answer that heart cry. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. God bless everyone this morning, and I hope that you've just enjoyed the online service. And just a little shout out to April. April, thank you so much for just this dear note. And you know what? You are so precious to our church family, and we just love you. And we're praying with you. And just wanted to kind of say that today. Jesus loves you. Yes, Jesus loves you too. Thank you. God bless each one. Enjoy one another today. See you guys next week online. God bless.